Good afternoon again to all of you. So we will be discussing today about retinal imaging. So making a diagnosis in retina has been improved a lot with the new imaging techniques, and all of us would need to know how to correlate these imaging techniques, which specific imaging technique is better for a particular condition, which you can avoid, and sometimes the imaging might also confuse. So let us start with our instruction course. I welcome all my co-instructors and thank them for this. And first, Dr. Abhinya would be presenting about OCT and OCT angiography, and telling you something about some things we never saw before and some new terminology. Dr. Abhinya, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. So we all know about OCT and OCT nowadays, but what we are going to see is the newer terminologies which have been recently defined on the OCT. So OCT is a non-invasive imaging tool which has high resolution, allows us wide field of view, about 12 mm, and it has been used for various purposes, from diagnosis to the management. The international nomenclature for optical coherence tomography in 2014, they have described the various 18 layers, from posterior cortical vitreous to the sclerochoroidal junction, and also have considered the histological comparison. We all have seen cystoid macular edema, the characteristic cystoid spaces which are present, but the NFAS imaging allows us segmentation through a particular layer. Like in this case, it is the outer plexiform where we see the cystoid spaces on the NFAS imaging. Another utilization of the NFAS image, this is an article from the Ophthalmology Retina, recent one, where they have described various spaces in the vitreous. Basically, this is the premacular bursa, this is the peripapillary Martigny space, there are cystine spaces which are present, also prevascular fissures which are there, and their connection to each other. Now, the upper three images are from the 24-year-old young patient, and the three lower three images are from the elder patient, where there are abnormal connection presence between these spaces. This is again the vertical scan image where there is elongation seen in an elder patient, elongation of the premacular bursa. So this is being now studied for the vitreous, basically for the physiological changes which are present, which has been previously only described on histopathology. Myopic traction, in myopic cases, sometimes the retina might be completely normal. But when we see OCT, we could appreciate the vitromacular traction, tabletop configuration, presence of the macular hole, or myopic traction maculopathy, macular schisis present. But in myopia, there are few newer terminologies also present, which have been described on OCT specifically. And one of them is dome-shaped maculopathy, where fundus, sometime it may be completely normal. Some patients may be referred as mass lesions. But when you do a OCT, you see that there is a convex area, convexity present in the area of the staphylomatous. Now, this could be of three types: symmetrical, vertical dome-shaped macula, or a horizontal dome-shaped macula. Now, if you do only a horizontal scan, you might just miss this. And hence, both horizontal as well as vertical scan is important in these cases to identify them. Now, in these cases, may also have subretinal fluid. Now, this subretinal fluid usually resolves with time. You do not need to treat them. This can be misdiagnosed as CSC, and you may treat this patient for no reason. So knowing this entity is important. Another thing is macula, because of the dome-shaped macula, it acts like a macular buckle. So there are less chances this patient of having foveal schisis, but more chances of having extra foveal schisis. Another differential diagnosis of dome-shaped maculopathy, and also this patient presents with myopic astigmatism, is the tilted disc syndrome. Again, if you see the horizontal scan is completely normal, but when you see the vertical scan, you see that there is steepening present. Clinically, this patient usually have tilted disc, inferior crescent, nasalization of the vessels, and asymmetric chororetinal degeneration. On OCT, characteristically, we see the steepening area. Also, this edges are the area where there could be formation of CSC, formation of subretinal fluid, CNVM, and also foveal schisis could be present in these areas. This is again TDS, which has presented with myopic traction maculopathy. ERM, we just heard about a small discussion before. We all have seen the usual ERM on OCT. Now there's a newer terminology, which is lamellar hole associated epiretinal proliferation, that is LHEP. Now the difference here, you see that there is a thick homogeneous membrane which spans the retinal layer. This is medium reflectivity, it is completely attached to the retina, and the origin is suggested to be Müller cells, and therefore they are said to be connected to the middle retinal layers. Importance, again, this patient have more amount of that yellow tissue, therefore they could be a tear present. When you try to peel it, it is difficult to peel, high chances of macular hole formation, and overall prognosis of lamellar hole associated with epiretinal proliferation is poorer than those without. That's why it is important to know this terminology. Another differential of an ERM in a young child is combined hematoma of the retina and retinal pigment epithelium, where we see that there is thickening on OCT specifically, thickening of the inner retinal layers, there is peaking of the middle layers, and which is bounded by the outer plexiform layer. Now, there is most of the cases do not have any retinal pigment epithelium involvement was seen. Another typical sign, omega sign, has been described for the same. Disorganization of the retinal inner layers, basically it is disorganization described in diabetics patient, diabetic macular edema, where there is disorganization of the inner layers involving the ganglion cell plexiform. This has also been seen in other disorders like vascular occlusions and uveitic patients. Also, there is ellipsoid layer abnormalities which could be present. The importance of this is the extent of the drill is correspond to the visual prognosis. More the extent of the drill, more the visual prognosis is poor. This is a clinical photo where you see the patient presented with scotomas and there was mild alteration in the perifoveal area. On OCT, typically, we saw that there was some hyperreflectivity present in the outer inner nuclear layer. Again, more clearly seen on the lower image. So this was a case of parafoveal acute medial maculopathy. On OCT, what we saw that there was few void spaces present in the perivascular area. On NFAS imaging, again, the fern-like pattern was typically seen. Now this is, PAM is specifically an OCT diagnosis and again to be differentiated from acute macular neuroretinopathy, where again this patient's also present with scotoma, perifoveal changes might be present. But when we see OCT, what we see is the most of the deeper retinal layer involvement. There is outer plexiform involvement and there is some ellipsoid zone abnormalities present in these cases. Coming to outer retinal layers, there is outer retinal tubulation. Usually these are hypospaces which are lined by hyperreflective ELM. Mostly described with AMD cases and they are sign of poor visual prognosis. They indicate that the photoreceptor layer is lost and there is degenerating RP present. But they have also been described in other retinal dystrophies and choroideremias. Like in this, the lower one is an image from a BTE's crystalline dystrophy. Coming to outer layers, again there is focal choroidal excavation, which is ectasia, abnormal ectasia due to abnormal development. Again, unclear etiology. There could be of two types, conforming type and non-conforming type. This is the conforming type which is present, and this is the non-conforming type, where the retinal layers do not follow the choroidal excavation. Seen in the peripapillary area. The importance of this is this: there is some abnormality present over there, and this they are high prone to develop CNVM over a period of time. That is why it is important to follow up these cases. Apart from myopic, focal choroidal excavation mostly seen in myopic, they could also be seen in other disorders, and that could be, this is a case of osteoma where a large choroidal defect was seen. The lower one is a Stargardt disease where again a choroidal excavation was seen. This is a best disease with a focal choroidal excavation. Whether it is a cause or an effect, that is still query. So here we see that there is some changes present in the peripapillary area of whitish. Differential diagnosis, peripapillary, some choroiditis or granuloma-like feature, peripapillary CNVM, hemangioma, clinically could be confused. But when we see the OCT, we see that there is a clear cavity present in the choroid, which is more seen, more clearly seen on the 3D structure to be empty space, suggestive of the peripapillary intrachoroidal cavitation. Coming to OCT angiography, a dialysis angiography, which is based on the RBC blood flow principle, where retinal, choroidal, and optic disc vasculature is clearly defined. We see areas of dark pixel, which is no flow area, and areas of white pixels, which is suggestive of the flow. Various layers can be defined from superficial retinal layer to the choroid layer. Now, CNVMs have been seen on, there could be type 1, type 2 CNVM, but what we could make out is the vascular flow clearly present on the OCT, which will be covered up later by the other presenters. Type 2 CNVM, again, here in type 2, one of the things which is important is where you are segmenting the OCT. That is very important whenever you are looking at an OCTA. Here we see that there are deeper layer involvement also present, choriocapillaries also, there is a membrane present. Now this was a patient who had come with a scar in one eye, and the other eye showed drusen with a single bleed which was there. On FA imaging, there was a hyperreflective leakage present in one area. And on OCT, there was cuticular drusen with cystoid spaces. When we did OCTA, we saw that there was high flow, vascular flow present in the deep retinal vessel, which was extending to the outer retina. This was suggestive of retinal angiomatosis proliferance. We are also not seeing, trying about a OCTA guided PDT, where the neovascular membrane is completely measured on OCTA, and using that PDT can be performed. This is, there's pigmentation seen in this patient where on OCT or retinal hole was seen, outer retinal hole was seen. This was a case of IPFT, idiopathic parafoveal telangiectasia, when on OCTA we saw that there were telangiectatic vessel present on the deeper retinal layer. So OCTA can help us identify, characteristically identify this patients and also their complications. Now this was a case of again parafoveal telangiectasia with CNVM. On FA we can see the leak. On OCTA, what we saw that there was telangiectatic vessels present in the deeper retinal layer, but also in the choriocapillary layer, there was vascular flow present, suggestive of the CNVM. Sir, this is the last slide.
Okay.
So to complete, there is comparison between OCTA and fluorescein angiography. This was a thesis run from our own center, where we saw that various features like microaneurysm, CNP areas, neovascularization, could be characteristically identified on OCTA. Thank you.
I would like to welcome Dr. Joel Hanhart, and would like to invite him to be ready for the next talk. He's our keynote speaker. His talk is on pregnancy and the eye. Until he's ready, we can take a few questions or any comments. So Dr. Abhinaya has basically given us an overview of some of the new findings which we see on OCT, which we were not seeing before just on a fundus examination, and some new terminology and how it can help us in making some diagnosis. Any comments?
So few of these conditions are of paramount importance. One of the examples Dr. Abhinaya showed was a patient with myopia, and she on OCT was found to have subretinal fluid. Now very commonly these patients will be misdiagnosed as CSC, and follow up, they undergo follow up, long follow up and treatment. But remember, when you see a patient who looks like a CSC, and you see this patient on clinical photograph, and you find that patient is actually having a myopia, you must do a vertical scan in these particular patients. And if you see elevation of the underlying choroid, then we are sure that we are dealing with a case of dome-shaped macula rather than CSC. Now, it is important to diagnose this patient, though these patients at times will behave like CSC, but the fluid typically waxes and wanes, and it is very difficult to get rid of this fluid. And it is a common cause of vision loss in patients with high myopia. So there are these. This is just one such example, and we will be able to find many such diagnoses in our clinical scenario when we use our technology to its best.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for the invitation. I hope we'll have it now. Yeah. Oh, they're just doing some works here on the computer. Okay, I'm just waiting for. Yeah, so we can start. So nice to meet you. I come from Jerusalem, from a university center where we deal with a lot of birthes. And I just want to emphasize here the advantage of being in touch with other departments. We all love multimodal imaging, but mostly deal with specific ophthalmology conditions. Now we will try to expand our horizons to other things. Many advices are requested from obstetrics to ophthalmology department, particularly when you deal with complicated pregnancy. I mean, twin and more, and where you have a higher prevalence of eclampsia, preeclampsia, and so on. We all witnessed during the last decade a huge development in non-invasive ophthalmology diagnostic capacities, and we should look at pregnant people, pregnant women, as a population at risk from certain points. So a lot of has been published, or not so much, but enough to have some idea, but there is not so much information about what to do with OCT angiography, for instance, and pregnancy. So I will try to address those topics now. First of all, we have to be aware of some restrictions with pregnant women. We cannot use fluorescent angiography as we wish. We all are really keen to perform all kind of wide field angiographies, particularly when we want to deal with diabetic patients. But here we have to take care because of teratogenicity concern associated with the use of this technology. We know that the fluorescein crosses the placenta barrier, and which is the fetus where it's very when we deal with anti-VEGF treatment, it's also a big concern because there VEGF is very active in babies in the womb. So despite the fact that there are today, to our knowledge, there have not been any case report of birth anomalies or complications. If we can perform other imaging modalities, so it would be better. We all know that we have OCT, OCT angiography, and we can use it really safely in pregnant patients. As I previously told you, VEGF is very important in the development of human fetus, and we shouldn't use it, or if we have to use it, it should be do it with the greatest care. So if with regard to treatment, we have to speak of alternative laser treatments and steroids and so on. So what are the problems? Now let's leave the technology, but what are the clinical problems of pregnant women in the retina? So the most common problem is diabetic retinopathy. And when we speak of diabetic retinopathy, we deal with people being diabetic before pregnancy, not for gestational pregnancy diabetes. But out of diabetes, you have other conditions such as preeclampsia and eclampsia, which were primarily the eye, and rural things such as disseminated intravascular coagulopathy, amniotic fluid embolism, but the eye generally is the smallest issues because here there is a concern that the woman can lose her life in such conditions. Another thing, not so uncommon in pregnancy is central surgical retinopathy, usually in the final trimester, and one hypothesis is that it's the result of increased catecholamines during pregnancy. We also see more artery and vein occlusions, wide syndromes, and idiopathic or not so idiopathic retinal neovascularization due to increased activity of angiogenic factors too. What with regard to diabetic retinopathy, so it's very, very common when you try to screen pregnant people for diabetic retinopathy, so you'll find that till 60% of women entering pregnancy with type 1 diabetes and till 30% of type 2 diabetes have some kind of diabetic retinopathy. And for sure, people with type 1 diabetic retinopathy should be seen as a very high risk population. On the other hand, when a woman presents diabetes for the first time during pregnancy, so it's very, very rare. Only case reports that she will develop proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So I don't know how it works in India, but in Israel usually for most ethnic people, ethnic groups, you don't have a very, very fast progression during the life. You have to wait a decade or 2 decades from diagnosis of diabetes till you see proliferative diabetic retinopathy. In pregnancy, it's another thing. So how can imaging help? So we all love multimodal imaging and but a lot of slides with all kinds of flows and geography, but here we should remind that we are, first of all, clinical practitioners, and we should use our lenses and just look what's happening in the retina, and for sure we can also perform wide field pictures without injecting any dye. Just to remember that this modality also exists in Optos and other wide field capturing systems, and OCT and OCT angiography can help us a lot. So just to remind, gestational diabetes, you do not specific eye examination with pregnancy, but people entering pregnancy with already diagnosed diabetes should be really, really pictured and regularly seen. What do we find in preeclampsia? Just leave diabetes. In preeclampsia, you have all kinds of things that we should check clinically. Hypertensive retinopathy, occlusions, hypertensive choroidopathy, more difficult to catch, but you can see the alginic spots, and you can have some serous retinal detachments. The most common ocular finding in preeclampsia is severe arteriolar spasms, something that you should discover with your eye, without any other technology. But if already we use technology, so in eclampsia, you can see all kind of things. That's an example of swab source, OCT angiography, and UNFAS pictures there. And I also put some retinal thickness mapping just to show that it's not only the artifact related to the presence of intraretinal fluids. What you see is huge changes in UNFAS, and when you specifically look at the vasculature, you see changes. Some kind of fast enlargement, and the overall vascular pattern has changed. What's most worrying is that when the patient clinically recovers and when you don't see any flows with structural OCT, you still see some change, some vascular signs. And that's a composite image, so just to emphasize the deep plexus non-homogeneity, and you can see that peripherally you have some important changes there. So just to conclude with this presentation and to leave some room for questions, we should have a definitely large threshold for referral and ophthalmologic check as more accurate diagnostic tools emerging, but we should, as clinicians, when a woman is referred, a pregnant woman, for any ocular complaint, just first of all, we rely on our clinical and common senses. OCT angiography will likely change our understanding of pregnancy, induced retinal vascular changes in normal and complicated pregnancy. And we are currently performing some research in the hospital where I work, at Shaarei Tzedek Hospital in Jerusalem, comparing a group of complicated, namely preeclamptic and eclamptic pregnant women with uncomplicated pregnancy and non-pregnant. For the former results we see, there are some vascular changes. For sure, the most difficult things when you do research with OCT angiography is just to quantify the changes. But morphologically speaking, when you try to compare the texture of the vascular tissue, of the choroid, or even of the outer retinal plexus, you do see some changes between those groups. So it may become one of the biomarkers obstetricians will use in the future, just to detect what specific group of women are at risk of having all the eclampsia complications. Thank you so much for your patience and attention.
Thank you, sir. So I would just like to ask you, since you have done so many OCT angiographies in preeclampsia patients, did you find a large majority of them having vascular changes, or just a minority?
We do. The main problem is the artifact related to fluids. When you deal with patients who are symptomatic, so usually they complain of some metamorphopsia or some blur related to the presence of fluids. So when you try to not to take into consideration the intraretinal fluids, you do see some changes. You do. It's very hard to characterize and to quantify that. But when you compare, when you take two images and you ask yourself which woman has some complications, you point the right image, and we are trying just to translate it now statistically.
So maybe if the patient is just symptomatic and comes to you early, then you might be able to predict by the imaging whether they.
That might be a good idea, just to put OCT angiography. If we find some difference, to put it in the regular follow-up of those patients.
Thank you. Any other questions, please?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. We now go on to the next talk. all of us have been diagnosing central serous retinopathy, and these days with OCT, whenever we see some subretinal fluid, the first thing that comes to our mind is it CSR? But many times the presence of fluid may not be CSR and it may be something else. So I think Dr. Deepak will shed some light on that. Dr. Deepak, please.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. As we all know, central serous chorioretinopathy is a great mimicker because of its overlapping features with various other diseases, as well as because of its atypical presentations. I'm here to discuss on certain case scenarios. I'm going to discuss on certain close differentials of CSC. So this was a case, and a 25-year-old male who presented with diminution of vision. He had a neurosensory detachment involving the fovea and almost extending till the optic disc. And apart from that, we couldn't make out anything on initial fundus examination. On further doing an OCT, we picked up an NSD. It looked like CSC initially. And another section, it was looking like some kind of outer retinal sciatic cavities were visible, and it looked like optic disc pit maculopathy too. Apart from that, there was a hyperreflective breach which was visible here. So this corresponded to some kind of a membrane which was breaching the RPE. On further doing another type of fundus examination, we re-examined the patient. We could make out there was a whitish membrane here which corresponded to this RPE breach. So this was a case of CNVM, and we confirmed it with the help of OCTA. OCTA was able to pick up this high flow membrane which was initially not noticed by us. Sometimes a simple case of CNVM can mimic CSC. This patient showed response with anti-VEGF, and the fluid decreased as well as the vision improved. Another case, the patient had neurosensory detachment as well as subretinal hard exudates were visible in this particular case. And FAF showed some stipple hyperhoder fluorescence, and FFA showed some pinpoint leaks nasal to the fovea. And ICJ was not that much informative. And OCT showed a PED with an evolving double layer sign, as we can see here. And some kind of neurosensory detachment was also visible. So this could either be, apart from that, there was also a choroidal pachychoroid which can be seen here. A choroidal thickness is somewhat increased here. So this could either be a CSC or it could be a CNVM or PCV2. But since we cannot prove the membrane on any kind of imaging, as well as polyps were not visible, we've still made a diagnosis of pachychoroid CSC. And we had advised reduced fluence PDT. The patient showed good response with PDT. The PD size decreased as well as the vision improved. Another patient was regularly following up in our retina clinic, and he was a known case of chronic CSC. Suddenly he developed diminution of vision in his right eye, as we could notice. We can see some sudden subretinal streaks of blood here. So we suspected the patient was developing another vascular pathology, maybe a CNVM or PCV. We did an imaging, and we could make out that there is some hypersinusine structures here in the ICG. So these were nothing but newly developing polyps. So the patient was converting from chronic CSC to PCV. As we could see here, on the right side of the image, there are large serosanguinous PEDs here, as well as double A sign, as well as notching in the PED. So this is a typical OCT of a PCV case, whereas the other eye we can see a typical OCT of a CSC case. Sometimes these come under the same spectrum, so they can convert anytime. So these vascular pathologies, CSC, CNV, and PCV, can mimic each other, and because they have a lot of overlapping features. Subretinal fibrin can also mimic a CNVM membrane. OCTA can be useful in picking up these membranes easily, which can be missed on FFA. Of course, ICG might be useful in picking up the polyps. So coming on another case, she was a 20-year-old female who had no systemic compliance. She had vision loss, vision drop to 6x24 in her right eye. She had multiple pockets of subretinal fluid, as we can see here, around the fovea. Apart from that, there was some subretinal whitish hue was also seen here. So this was looking it's a bit of atypical to us. Then we ordered imaging, and FA showed early hypo, late hyper kind of lesions here. As we can see, multiple pinpoint leaks involving a particular zone look like a starry sky. ICG showed some early hypo, but it is not that significantly seen here. OCT showed NSDs as well as PEDs. So we found out that this patient was a case of APMPP, acute posterior multifocal pachyoid pigment epitheliopathy. Many cases of neurosensory detachments have been reported with APMPP, and we started her on oral steroids of 1 mg per kg, and she showed response at 5 days. As we can see, the NSD also reduced as well as the fluid also came down. But one day after that, we were able to confirm that it was not a case of CSC. Sometimes multifocal CSC can also behave like, can provide a similar picture. Another patient who had neurosensory detachment also had a reddish, orangish fundus here, as we can see. And OCT showed RP as well as ILM undulations, which were unlikely to be that of CSC, as well as whitish dots were also visible. And ICG showed a typical dark areas which were scattered throughout the posterior pole. And FA also showed late staining of the optic disc. So this was the case of VKH. VKH can also mimic CSC. We started him on oral steroids. So these posterior uveitis, VKH, and sympathetic ophthalmia cases can masquerade CSC. A good proper anterosegment examination might rule out features of panuveitis. Apart from that, RPE undulations, ILM undulations, and OCT can be useful in picking up VKH, as well as diffuse choroidal hyperpermeability, disc leak, and numerous leaky points on FA can have a suspect on VKH. Another patient, as we can see, a neurosensory detachment bilaterally symmetrical on both the eyes. Apart from that, what we can see is that there's some kind of subretinal yellowish lesions. These corresponded to these RP humps, as we can see here. FA showed a stipple fluorescence. So this was a case of adult onset foveal vitelliform dystrophy. Sometimes the best trophinopathies, the best disease spectrums can mimic CSC. So the subretinal yellowish dots, which are hyperautofluorescent on FAF and hyperreflective on OCT, can be suggestive of best disease. So in this particular case, OCT looks like CSC, both the eyes looks like CSC to me, but fundus was quite atypical. They had multiple atypical yellowish lesions with RP pigmentary changes, with neurosensory detachments, which were hyperautofluorescent on FAF. So this was a case of acute exudative polymorphous vitelliform maculopathy. Sometimes these patients can have a best like phenotype, no? That's because of an infectious or inflammatory stimulus. This is another new entity which has been described. Another patient who had neurosensory detachment on both the eyes. But apart from that, what we can notice on keen observation on fundus examination is that there is a choroidal excavation also here. I mean, optic disc excavation seen here on both the eyes. So this was a case of optic disc pit maculopathy. Even if you miss optic disc pits on fundus, OCT can be useful in picking up the diagnosis because there can be a lot of cytic cavities and the neurosensory detachment can almost extend till the optic disc. And apart from that, there can be lamellar holes, outer lamellar holes also seen. FA doesn't show any particular leaky point. Another rare case, and this was a known retropositive patient who presented to us in our clinic, and she had multiple subretinal detachments, fluids all around. OCT showed fluid intraretinal, in the intraretinal space, as well as subretinal space, preretinal whitish dots as well as were visible. So we did further blood investigations when we found out that the patient was developing leukemia on peripheral smear. So sometimes leukemia can present itself as exudative detachment. Not necessarily that every leukemia has to present with white-centered hemorrhages. Sometimes these leukemic cells can infiltrate the choriocapillaries and cause RP dysfunction and ultimately leading to exudative detachments. These patients can be managed on steroids or even a simple chemo can be useful in. Another patient, this patient had neurosensory detachment. Apart from that, what we can see is again there's some kind of RP humps here. On autofluorescence, what we can see is these RP deposits are typically arranged in a pattern fashion. Apart from that, we can see the pigment tracks also seen. Again, this looked unlikely to be CSC for us. On further deeply probing the history, only we were able to find out that the patient was a known case of SLE. So sometimes SLE choroidopathy can cause such kind of lesions. Apart from the blocked hyperfluorescence caused by the FF, these RP deposits, there's nothing significant on FFA and ICGA. Because these autoantibodies are directly acting against the RP, these RP can be dysfunction and they can cause neurosensory detachments. So this is a case of SLE pigment epithelopathy or SLE choroidopathy. This was another patient and there was some kind of a elevation here, but the vessels were not actually elevated. Start from the superior retina and extended towards the fovea. We did an OCT, we found out that there was only an ILM detachment when the retina was totally attached. Further in history and examination, we found out that this was a case of valacellular retinopathy. The subilum bead had dissolved and left a subilum cleft. The subilum clefts can also mimic a case of CSC. Another case, this case had a neurosensory detachment here, but apart from that, what we can see is that there's some kind of choriocapillary or choroidal abnormality here. The fundus examination showed a hyperpigmented patch here corresponding to this NSD. What do you think this case could be? This was a case of torpedo maculopathy. which we found out only with the help of fundus autofluorescence, as we could see a pear shape or a torpedo lesion extend from temporal to the fovea corresponding to the neurosensory detachment. So this was a case of torpedo maculopathy with choroidal cavitations. Sometimes these patients can also mimic a case of CSC. So coming to my last case, this patient had multiple subretinal detachments and subretinal whitish membranes, which were seen throughout the fundus. OCT showed neurosensory detachments, pigment epithelial detachments, and subretinal whitish hyperreflective membranes were also seen down here. FFA showed multiple areas of ink blot fluorescence, as well as pooling and block fluorescence down here. What do you think this case could be? This was a case of multifocal CSC itself. So sometimes CSC can itself has certain atypical presentation, so you will not think too much, it can be a simple case of CSC. So concluding my presentation, a careful good careful good history can itself prove out, validate certain important points like SLE leukemia, where we were able to find out only with the help of history. A good fundus examination can pick up optic disc pit, subretinal streaks of blood, which are very minutely seen only on 90D examination sometimes. OCT can be useful in picking up RP in ILM undulations and subretinal septations, which you have to turn around the diagnosis to weak edge. OCTA can be helping you in picking up certain fine membranes which are not visible on FFA. Autofluorescence is useful in bestrophinopathies and best group of diseases. FFA is useful in picking up disc leak, vascular leak, etc. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. So as he has shown, a simple fluid under the retina, the etiology can range from leukemia to dystrophies to vascular membranes to SLE. So there can be a lot of differential diagnosis. So as he said, one should also pay attention to the systemic history and any abnormal findings apart from just fluid. If you see some thickening at the RP level, if you see white dots in the choroid, undulating RPE, if your leaks are not typical of ink blot or pattern, then it could suggest otherwise, and then you need the help of other imaging modalities such as ICG, which may show hypospots if it is a choroidal inflammatory type of pathology, or you may need to do an OCT angiography to detect vascular membranes. So all cases of simple CSC might not be very simple. Any questions for him or anyone? Okay, so I welcome Dr. Vinod for the next talk. Would you like to add anything specific till Vinod is ready?
So again, what Deepak very nicely showed you, a variety of cases. All we wanted to highlight that when you see a OCT scan, just don't interpret a single OCT scan. You have to first consider your imaging modality, other imaging modalities, and the clinical picture. We cannot interpret any modality for that matter without taking care of the clinical picture of the patient. So that is the message we wanted to pass on, and it is important to know that SRF can occur in a variety of conditions. So I'd like to share with you some of conditions where again the message would be the same, that do not interpret a single scan or single modality of investigation. So I'll be showing you certain cases where OCTA helped us and then OCTA also confused us. So can we have the slides, please?
The OCTA has now started showing us these new membranes where we sometimes didn't even expect to find membranes. But should we be treating all membranes, and what is the end point when we should stop treating? All these are unanswered questions. I think Dr. Vinod will shed some light on this.
So OCTA, we know, is the latest advancement in the retinal imaging. It is the dialysis angiography, and that's why we like to do it very often. And the present literature has shown that it is especially useful in detecting CNVs, where it is not usually easy to detect the CNVM. Some of these disorders include macular telangiectasia or idiopathic macular telangiectasia, choroidal osteomas, pachychoroid disorders, and AMDs. But remember, technology should improve our life and not become our life. So I'll share with you a few cases where it helped. Whether it was of clinical significance or not, it remains to be proven. So first, let's have a look at a few of the pachychoroid spectrum diseases. So this is the first case who presented to us with decrease in vision in the left eye. The visual acuity was 6/9 in the left eye. There's some irregular pigmentary changes at the foveal area. So as we do first, we did a OCT scan, which did show a small serous PD and overlying small serous detachment. In one of another scans, we could see that there is some hyperreflectivity beneath this serous PED. Now, because of this, we did a fluorescein angiogram, and on fluorescein angiogram, we could see some very faint hyperfluorescence, which came in the early phases and increased slightly over a period of time. And as we were doing in our initial days, we did OCTA scan, and the OCTA was indeed clean, that there was no CNVM complex either in the deep part or either on the B scans. Now, we just juggled a bit of this B scan, and we could see in the hump of two PEDs, there was some vascularity here, which could be seen in the deep plexus. So what we learned from this case was that OCTA can show you tiny hidden CNVs in such disorders. Now remember, this CNV, as of now, we would not like to treat because the patient is not very symptomatic, but this is the patient who needs a very close follow-up. Let's go to our second case. Again, a 60-year-old male who presented known case of CSC with some pigment disturbances at the posterior pole. The visual acuity was 6/6. The patient underwent a OCT scan, and you can see there is a flat, irregular pigment epithelial detachment over here, and you can see the pachy vessels, which are virtually obliterating the choriocapillaries, which are overlying them. So we knew that we are dealing with a case of healed CSC over here, and normally we would not have treated this patient, but see what a OCT angiogram shows. We can see a well-defined network beneath this flat, irregular PED. Now, you can see this vascularity even on the OCTA B scans. And now we know that there is definitely a membrane which is lying over there. But whether it needs treatment, since patient is not symptomatic, it does not need treatment as of now. But this patient needs, a very close follow-up, as the exudation can start at any given point of time, and patient should be given a very close follow-up. So lesson we learned from this patient is that OCTA can show CNV in places where we do not even suspect. Now have a look at this particular case. Again, a little bit of pigmentary disturbances at the posterior pole. It's a 40-year-old male, 6/36, history of 6 months. Left eye was normal. AF did show some pigmentary disturbances in the center of the macula, and OCT showed a clear-cut fluid. The OS was normal, the left eye was normal, and in view of the fluid in the right eye, we did a FA as well as ICG, which did show some stippled hyperfluorescence both on FFA as well as ICG, which increased in the late phases. So we were pretty sure that we were dealing with the case of CNVM. We did a OCT A, and again it showed very nicely that there is a membrane here. So the patient underwent two injections of Avastin, and in fact, the fluid increased. So subsequently, the patient was lost to follow-up, came 3 months later, and again underwent ILIA, but the fluid more or less waxed and waned, and this CNV did not respond. Ultimately, this patient underwent half-lens PDT, and fluids nicely responded. But what you have to look carefully on autofluorescence, that there is a patch of RP atrophy. So all throughout what we have been seeing is basically underlying choroidal vessels and not a CNVM. So you have to be doubly sure when you interpret a CNV on OCTA in the presence of retinal pigment epithelium atrophy. So what we learned from this case is that all CNVMs which you see on OCTA may not be actually a CNV. Coming to a macular telangiectasia type 2, and the current literature suggests that OCTA is highly useful in detecting CNVs in the presence of macular telangiectasia. Now, this is a patient with typical MECTEL. You see right eye macular atrophy, left eye you can see obviously there is a CNVM with subretinal fluid, which is visible on FFA as well as on OCTA. Now, for this particular type of CNVM, one does not need any kind of imaging for detecting the CNVMs. But I'll show you some other cases. For example, this patient, again, some graying in the area of macular in both the eyes. Left eye shows some pigment plaques as well. On OCT, you can see there is atrophy which is present in the both the eyes. I'll show you a high definition OCT scan. We can see that there is some hyperreflectivity which is present in the retina due to the pigment plaques, but no edema whatsoever. But when you do a OCT scan, it very nicely shows a membrane there. Now, at that time, we were not very, this case is around 3 years old. We did not know whether to treat or not, but going by the clinical features of the patient, we did not treat. And see what happens 2 years later. Nothing happened, it remains the same. So over a period of time, we realized that it is actually not the CNVM, it is the vascular invasion of the deep retinal vessels which is happening into the avascular layer. So whatever you see as CNVM on OCTA is not necessarily a CNVM. So what we'll get over here is, again, you can get CNVMs in the cases of MACTL, which may not change over a period of time. Another case of MACTL, you see ill-defined leakage, OCT does not show much. This is the right eye, OCTA does not show any CNVM. But in the left eye, there was a little hemorrhage over here, and that's why we did FA in this particular patient, which did show some amount of leakage over here, but OCT scans did not show any evidence of CNVM. We did a OCTA scan, which did show a very well-defined CNVM in this patient. But this patient, because he was not very symptomatic, refused any treatment and came 2 years later with increase in the size of the CNVM, as you can see over here. But the patient maintained his vision even over a period of 3 years, and no treatment was required. So lesson we learned from this patient is that OCTA in MACTEL can detect CNVMs, which can enlarge over in time without any significant clinical change. So as of now, we would be seeing many CNVMs, but we all of them do not need to be treated. Coming to the third category, myopia. Now again, I'll show you a case, a 46-year-old female. You can see a very well-defined coin-shaped hemorrhage over here. But when you do a OCT scan, you can see a membrane which is breaching the retinal pigment epithelium. You do FFA, you can see a very nice membrane which is lying over there, though it is not very well seen on ICG angiogram because it is over the retinal pigment epithelium. But you do OCTA, you can very nicely see that membrane which is in the deep vascular network and also in the outer retina. So what we learned from this case is that in the setting of myopia, OCTA helps helps in making the diagnosis of CNVM and makes it very easy work, in fact. Now, this is another case, case number 7, a myope who had undergone 3 injections of anti-VEGF and did not respond. So this is the patient. You see a CNVM-like lesion over here. On AF, you can see hyperfluorescence due to the chronic fluid. On FFA, you can see there is ill-defined leakage which is increasing in the late phase. Now, you do OCT scan, there is definitely a membrane-like structure and subretinal fluid. So we also thought that this patient is a case of CNVM based on associated with myopia based on our imaging modalities. And the patient underwent 1 injection of anti-VEGF, and in fact, the fluid increased. Now, at this point of time, we did a OCT scan, OCTA, and there was no CNVM whatsoever. And I repeated this scan 3 months later, and again, there was no CNVM. So eventually we diagnosed this patient with a case of tilted disc syndrome, which had a chronic SRF leading to RP abnormalities. So what we learned from this case, that OCTA is very useful in refuting the diagnosis of CNVM. Another case, young male, myope, presented with coin-shaped hemorrhage and sudden decrease of vision. So what we can see is a subretinal hemorrhage, and you do another OCT scan, you can see there is some abnormality beneath this hemorrhage. Did a OCTA scan, does not show much, but if you see the B scan of this particular corresponding OCTA scan, you can see vascularity beneath that bump. So this is definitely a case of myopic macular CNVM, which has bled and needs treatment. So what we learn, again, OCTA can show hidden CNVMs in cases of myopia. My second last case, a very similar case, a coin-shaped hemorrhage, again in a young male with history of myopia, again a subretinal bleed. FA does show ill-defined leakage, but if you see OCT and OCTA, there are no evidence of CNVM, and so is, you see over here, subretinal hyperreflectivity, there's no vascularity here. So again, in the myopia as well, OCTA helps in refuting the diagnosis of CNVM. This is my last case. A case of around 40-year-old female who had this CNVM. In early phases, it did leak, and in late phases, minimum leakage. Well-defined CNVM on OCT, and which was visible on the OCT as well. But look at the history. It is a 46-year-old female who had idiopathic CNVM, had anti-VEGF outside, and the last injection was given 6 months back. That means this particular patient, as of now, has a dead CNVM or scarred CNVM. Thus, this does not need to be treated. So all, again, we learn that all CNVM we see on OCTA don't need treatment, and clinical details of the patients are of paramount importance. So to conclude, OCTA is a very useful modality. It helps in the diagnosis or refuting the diagnosis of CNVM. All CNVMs on OCTA don't need treatment, and clinical history and other modalities help in reaching us to a final diagnosis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vinod. I think you have done quite a good justice to your topic, which was whether OCTA confuses or whether it helps us detect the hidden ones. So it does both, but then you have to be very sure about the history and other findings and the treatment details to decide whether you want to continue treatment or not, as he has said. Any questions for him, please?
Exactly.
So people go on OCT findings and randomly these anti-VEGF is and I think overused or something. What do you suggest to them? How should they go ahead with just not
to give it unnecessarily?
I think, sir, OCTA just came 3-4 years back.
Yes.
And before that, we were also treating our patients without OCTA. And believe me, in 97-98% of our cases, with given all the clinical history, examination, and other treatment, other imaging modalities, we are correct in 98-99% of the cases. So these 10 cases I've chosen over, say, 4 years of period, we actually had to trace all these cases. And the cases, dicey cases where it will actually help are very few. But most of the cases you can deal with pure simple OCT based on your clinical history and your examination.
The other thing is that even if on OCTA we are seeing these early membranes, most of the studies are saying that we need to watch them and follow it and how it behaves. All of them do not merit treatment. Some of them may even be physiological. They might be even providing the nourishment to the photoreceptors. But at what point they tip and become pathological, we don't know. But when they do become pathological, start exuding, bleeding, then we definitely have to treat.
We should refer all these patients to centers where there is OCT.
No, like Dr. Vinod said, if you are in most of these, we are treating with OCT. And you, if you have a strong suspicion, you can go ahead with an anti-VEGF injection. But if you don't see a response, then don't persist. Then you think of an alternative diagnosis, and then you can go for other investigations.
So, for example, we commonly encounter an inflammatory CNVM with choroiditis patients. So, it's a healed choroiditis patient has come to us with metamorphopsia. So, we know that we are dealing with a case of CNVM. So, when you do imaging in such a patient, anyways, we have a high index of CNVM, and any signs of suggestive of CNVM in any of the imaging modalities, probably we go ahead and treat this patient, isn't it? But on the other hand, there is a patient with inflammatory CNVM and inflammatory choroiditis, and we happen to do OCT and find a CNVM. But the patient is asymptomatic, we are not going to treat this. So again, the message is that OCTA does show us certain things. As of now, we do not know whether we should treat them or not. As of now, we treat them based on the clinical picture of the patient rather than the imaging modality.
So monitoring can be done.
Exactly. So there are both set of patients again. One would be very apprehensive that nothing is being done, and one would be very apprehensive that a lot is being done. So we need to take care of the both.
So I invite Dr. Nasik, who will be talking on imaging in uveitis. How does it help?
Very good afternoon to one and all. Imaging. So imaging in uveitis. Well, uveitis is mostly very confusing for most of us. It is easy to label it as anterior uveitis, posterior uveitis, but often it is difficult to bring a cause, like determine a cause of it. So as I'll just start with saying that history and clinical examination is the most important, and it always overpowers your investigations. But what is the need for imaging in these patients? One, we can get to a diagnosis, we can get to a confirmed diagnosis. We might use it for prognostication, treatment purposes. And well, obviously, uveitis management is quite cumbersome. You don't know which patients respond to steroids, and some don't respond. Some develop steroid complications. Then the use of immunosuppressants and biologicals have all changed the management scenario of uveitis. So I'll be mostly talking about the different imaging modalities like OCT, fundus fluorescein angiography, ICG angiography, fundus autofluorescence, and OCTA. So before going into different cases, I'll just show you some classical signs that we see in most cases of uveitis. First, the choroidal thickening, which can be seen in most cases of choroiditis and panuveitis and other posterior uveitis. CME is seen even in anterior uveitis. Starting from anterior uveitis, you can go up to the posterior scleritis. You can still have patients with CME, which is quite common. Presence of subretinal fluid with cells in the subretinal space is also quite common in cases of posterior uveitis and panuveitis. And vitreous cells is something which is commonly seen in active inflammation. Coming to some classical signs in fluorescein angiography, the Fern pattern of leakage from the vessels is quite classical of Behçet's. Then peripheral vasculitis with NV and capillary non-perfusion areas can be caught in ultra-wide field angiography. Arterial aneurysms with peripheral vasculitis is again classical of Irvine. A petaloid appearance corresponds, petaloid appearance of hyperfluorescence corresponds to a CME, and disc leak again, which is quite common in acute inflammations. ICGA, there's the only classical sign I could think of is a hypospot, which is due to some inflammation blocking the choroidal sinuses. And on OCTA, we can easily catch up these hypoflow spots due to acute inflammation or CNVs in cases of healed choroiditis. So ultrasound T sign is very prominent, and it shows that the patient has posterior scleritis. So this T sign is nothing but accumulation of fluid in the subtenoid space. Now coming to each case one by one. The first one, you can see a fuzzy patch of retinitis at the posterior pole, and the corresponding FA shows a full thickness retina, hyperreflective involvement of the retina along with the hyaloid separation. So now we have made a diagnosis of toxoplasma retinitis because again the clinical examination was easy. So we started the patient on cotrimoxazole, and on 1 week follow-up, we saw that the lesion had decreased very well, and even the full thickness involvement had come a little down. And later on, at 1 month interval, a hyperreflective scar has started forming in the OCT. So this is a case, this was a case of post-fever retinitis, a non-toxoplasma retinitis, where you can see these retinitis patches around the supratemporal arcade and large subretinal fluid over here in the center. So even OCT showed us a full thickness retinal involvement, which is not involving the RPE, and a presence of a neurosensory detachment. On starting the patient on empirical tab doxycycline, the lesions completely disappeared, along with a gross reduction in the subretinal fluid. So in this clinical picture, what you can see is a plaque-like retinitis patch at the posterior pole with dilated and tortuous vessels. and retinal hemorrhages all around. So scanning through the plaque-like lesion, we could see a full thickness retina hyperreflective patch over here with some shadowing underneath, subretinal fluid, and some ILM separation around here. Starting the patient on, we diagnosed it as a herpetic retinitis. Starting the patient on tab valcyclovir, the plaque decreased very well along with marked foveal atrophy, and later on there was a scar formation in the posterior pole. So this patient came to us with hypopyon and non-dilating pupil, cells 4+. So we had started the patient on intensive topical steroids and cycloplegics, and on 1 week follow-up, what we noticed is this, the pupil dilated, and what we noticed is this white retinitis patch just close to the disc. So on doing an FA, the retinitis patch did cause some block fluorescence around here, but what we also noticed is the fern-like pattern of leakage around the vessels, which again, showed us it is a Behçet's disease. But again, history also told that the patient had aphthous ulcers, so we could diagnose with that also. So this is again a patient who came with a sudden diminution of vision, and now this is, classically, this is acute, this is leakage at the acute uveitic phase, where you can see multiple creamy lesions just below the retina with subretinal multiple NSDs. And looking at the FA, usually the starry sky, this is the this one early stage of FA where you can't see any, see very few pinpoint hemorrhages, but you can see gross blocked choroidal fluorescence over here. That is because of the delay in choroidal filling. And going to a later stage, going to the later stage of FA, you can see these pinpoint leaks enlarging to pool into these NSDs. And the OCT is classical for VKH or SO, where you can see these loculated subretinal fluid with subretinal cells and fibrous septa separating these fluid, these subretinal spaces. The next case, again, this was classically sympathetic ophthalmia because the other eye had a penetrating injury with a perf repair. So what you see here is, again, creamy lesions at the mid-equatorial region along with NSDs at the posterior pole, multiple NSDs at the posterior pole. Looking at the FA, there was disc leak. There was a starry sky pattern of pinpoint leaks. And the OCT showed a large collection of subretinal fluid, which was due to collation of the rest of the small subretinal fluids. And on starting the patient on intravenous methylprednisolone, what you could see is the lesions as well as subretinal fluid had completely disappeared. The disc leak had gone down, and again, the OCT had normalized. So this was a case, again, on examination, you can say this is a case of serpiginous choroiditis. The right is a heel serpiginous choroiditis, left is an active one, where you can see these creamy continuous lesions at the posterior pole with overlying retinal edema and disc edema. So again, OCT shows involvement starting from the choriocapillaries, choroid, and going up to the RPE and into the outer retina. So this is again a case of serpiginous choroiditis where you can see, this is classical, where you can see a heel lesion and can see these acute lesions starting at the edges of the heel lesion. An FAF fundus autofluorescence showed the same with a pigmented lesion over here, and you can see this hyper autofluorescent lesion starting at the edge of this heel lesion. An OCT shows a choroidal thickening along with the involvement of the choroid, the choriocapillaries, and it has started lifting the RPE, and it has gone over the RPE to the outer retina. Again, octa in this case shows a blocked hypoflow around here, which is due to the blocked blockage of the flow of the vessel, of the blood. So well, in this photo, what you can see is you can see these creamy placoid lesions in the posterior pole, multiple creamy placoid lesions in the posterior pole. So doing an FA, doing an autofluorescence showed hyper autofluorescent lesions, which shows that it is in the acute stage. Going to the FA, this is classical, where early stages show hyperfluorescent dots, and later stages it becomes hyperfluorescent. ICG again shows just these hypo spots, and the OCT showed involvement of the RP and the outer retina. Okay, so this was a case where you could see a yellowish plaque in the posterior pole along with a hypopigmented, depigmented halo, a grayish halo. So this is, and then you can see a dome-shaped hyperreflectivity at the OCT, which is starting from the RPE and the photoreceptors, and it is disrupting the ellipsoid zone and the interdigitation zone. So this is classical of an ARPE or a Crill's disease, acute retinal pigment epithelitis or a Crill's disease. And on starting the patient on steroids, the dome-shaped hyperreflectivity decreased in height. So this again looked like the previous one, where you have a black, you have a yellow creamy plaque in the posterior pole along with hypopigmented halo, and even this showed a like almost a dome-shaped lesion. But on healing, what happened is it formed a pigmented scar in the posterior pole. So this is another type, another form of serpiginous choroiditis, which is also called as macular form of serpiginous choroiditis, where you can see involvement at the RPE and over it also. So this is a case where you can see multiple small point creamy yellowish lesions at the posterior pole at the posterior pole around the fovea, and fundus autofluorescence showed a hyperautofluorescent posterior pole because of these from these small lesions. Well, doing an FA, we could see these punctate hyperfluorescent lesions at a wreath-like fashion. So this wreath-like configuration is classical for MUTES or multiple evanescent white dot syndrome. And on OCT, you can see these small pegs, pegs arising from the RP, which is again classical of MUTES. So this is a case of punctate in a choroidopathy along with CNM, which we could catch through using an octa. So this again, this might look like a well circumscribed network of vessels. You could confuse this with CNV, but then looking at the FA picture, you can see it's just an atrophy of the RP and the underlying choroidal choriocapillaries showing enhancing the underlying Sattler's layer. So this patient had come to us, she was a young girl, she had come to us with history of photopsia, and what we saw was this well demarcated yellowish lesion over here. If you see the FA and the ICG, it was nothing could be actually visualized. You can just see this well demarcated area, and then going on to the AF also, again there was nothing significant. But looking at the OCT, you can see this area, this part, which is when the scan was taken through the lesion, it showed disruption of the outer retinal layers, whereas the outer retinal layers were normal. So this was classically azure, but usually azure has this trisonal pattern where there's a central hyperfluorescence and hypoautofluorescence and then a hyperautofluorescence, but that comes in the later stages. This was picked up early. So this was another case which just looked like the previous case with a yellowish lesion at the posterior pole, well demarcated. On doing an autofluorescence, we could see this hyperfluorescence. So first we diagnosed this azure. But then on doing the OCT, we found that there was gross disruption of the photoreceptors with thickening of the RPE and some hyperreflective spots of the choroid, which is classical of an acute syphilitic posterior polychoid chorioretinitis. Yeah, and the patient, and again, his VDRL and TPA were positive. So this patient, we just saw a preretinal hemorrhage right at the disc, and then we went on to do an FA, and we found, obviously, there was block fluorescence with disc leak, but there was also a fern-like pattern of leakage around the vessels. Again, patient had Behçet's. Yeah, just so this was a case of Irwan with arterial aneurysms and peripheral vasculitis. Just go on. Just 1 minute. East vasculitis, which was active on steroids, that resolved.
I think and conclude the last slide.
Okay. So we'll just go to the last slide. Posterior scleritis with the T sign, which are resolved on steroids. And lastly, this was a case which came with vitritis, and on examination we saw this RP stippling over here, and it was actually a case of primary vitreoretinal lymphoma with these RP bumps. Thank you.
Dr. Nasik has tried to show you a lot of cases. There is a lot of variety in uveitis, but I think the main aim in imaging is you should try to localize which layer is primarily involved. Is it the inflammation coming from the retina first, or is it the choroid first? Like he showed few cases of retinitis. So if the lesion initially starts from a retina, then goes towards the choroid, it is more like a retinochoroiditis and more of a toxoplasma sort of lesion. And the other ones which he showed, the plaque-like white patches on the retina, those we have seen to be more of viral sort of herpetic retinitis, which causes a lot of necrosis of the retina, just leaves you with the ILM. And then if you have hyperreflective dots in the choroid or humps in the choroid and subretinal hyperreflective material just above the RP, that means this is a case coming from below. So it is a choroiditis going upwards, correlated with the ICG and FA findings. And then you can distinguish between various varieties such as APMPP or VKH, or if the history is suggestive, sympathetic ophthalmia. So again, the imaging will show you similar features, but corroborating with the other clinical findings will help you make a diagnosis. Any other questions in uveitis? So I think in uveitis, probably more of the clinical diagnosis is more important rather than the imaging, but it does help in some of these cases. So I think
now I'll invite Dr. Rohan. He'll be speaking on large lesions in the choroid retina, imaging to the disc cube. And we know that traditionally it's very difficult to diagnose with proceed with the diagnosis of these lesions. The reason being the only imaging modality available with us was the ultrasound, and OCT, when even though it was available, it could not penetrate deep enough into the choroid, and or the scans were not large enough to cover whole of the lesion. So now we have variety of other imaging modalities which can help us to reach a particular diagnosis. So Dr. Rohan is going to elaborate on that.
Thank you, Dr. Vinod. So I'll be talking about some large lesions of the chorioretina, which sometimes confuse us on what the diagnosis is. So like we have already been stressing, most important is a clinical examination. Unless you study your lesion well, what are the associated changes with the lesion and the history of the patient, it becomes difficult to arrive at a diagnosis, and these only will guide you to your correct investigations. So what does the investigation in imaging show you? It enhances your morphological analysis. It definitely tells you more about the microanatomy and the vascular relation of the lesion, whether it is the retinal vasculature, intrinsic vasculature, or it is related to the choroidal vasculature. And these investigations also tell you what is happening to the retinal pigment epithelial function. So can you spot a lesion in this fundus image? Well, actually there is a similar orange to brown colored slight hump here, just peripapillary region. If you do an OCT angiography scan, you see that this lesion is composed of some anomalous vessels, and this section has been taken through a mid-choroidal level. So these are some anomalous vessels at the choroidal level. OCT shows you the secondary changes, the neurosensory detachment. Such similar lesions would on an ultrasound give you a convex hump, which is smooth dome shape with moderate uniform reflectivity. And the ICG and FA also show you that these lesions have intrinsic vascularity with no other secondary changes other than the fluid. So these are choroidal hemangiomas, which can be treated by PDT, or if extrafoveal, can also be treated by focal laser. And you generally get a good response. The fluid resolves. The lesion may not reduce so much in height, but the patient's vision definitely improves. Another such lesion, and the OCT of this cut has been taken through the lesion. Here I want to emphasize is that you can clearly see that the lesion is coming from the choroid, bumping the RP upwards. These are secondary changes. But even if you take a closer look at the vasculature here, it is definitely different from normal choroidal vasculature, but some vasculature is present. So even if you don't have an OCTA, the OCT itself is telling you that this is a choroidal lesion with some internal vasculature. And so thus we would likely, and considering its color and location, we would make a diagnosis of choroidal hemangioma again here. Large pigmented lesions mostly are easier to diagnose with some pigmentary changes. These are choroidal melanomas. Angiography sometimes may not reveal any intrinsic vasculature. They may be dark, but sometimes they may have a lot of dye uptake intrinsically also, apart from the overlying retinal vasculature. The ultrasound is more diagnostic. If you see these clear-cut dome-shaped, mushroom-shaped lesions with a defect in the choroid called choroidal excavation and a high angle kappa. Sometimes in amelanotic lesions you may have a confusion still, and then you will only have to resort to either a biopsy or an enucleation and a histopathology for a diagnosis. Now this patient came to us with these yellowish spots, multiple of them, and this was a slightly elevated lesion at this level with fluid. When you do the OCT, what you see is that this is a lumpy bumpy choroid with also some excavation happening here and subretinal fluid. Retina is normal. So a lumpy, bumpy choroid with such RP alterations, highly suggestive that something is coming into the choroid metastasizing. We did an CT scan and we found an adenocarcinoma of the lung. The FAF here also typically shows changes overlying the lesion as well as in the surrounding area. So it is sort of spreading even in the surrounding area, which is also suggestive of a metastatic sort of lesion. The other imaging mostly show a hypo pattern in the choroid. The patient fortunately was treated with chemotherapy and has just on chemotherapy showed a very good response, and all the fluid has resolved, but the RP changes even on the FA subsequently remain. These are other patients of metastasis where again you can see lesions with fluid and FAF showing adjacent to the lesion RP changes. Another patient where you don't have a distinct mass but multiple deposits under the retina, and the choroid with this exudative detachment, even this patient had an adenocarcinoma of the lung. The ultrasound of this patient tells you that the choroid is thickened, as well as the subretinal fluid is not clear. It has some infiltration, which made us do more investigation, specifically more systemic imaging. This lesion has already been shown to you. So this is actually an osteoma. So I just want to show you a typical OCT. Here you will see that the hump goes downwards. It pushes the sclera backwards rather than pushing the retina up. And you also see these lamellar sort of lines here, which tell you that these are probably lamellar bone sort of formation, and this is an osteoma. But the typical diagnosis would be made on an ultrasound, which will give you the very high reflectivity, and this would not be seen in a hemangioma. Now, as opposed to the previous yellow lesion, you see this again large, deep yellow lesion here. But what is the OCT showing? It is showing again the opposite configuration and some subretinal hyperreflective material here, which is exudation. So again, demand systemic investigation, and we find again on chest X-ray evidence of tuberculosis. This was a case of tuberculoma treated well with ATT and steroids. Lesion resolves. Because the retina was not that much involved, patient did regain good vision as the lesion resolves, and the choroid is also showing that the granuloma has gone. Similar cases, when it becomes more extensive, the granulomas tend to become more like a subretinal abscess, and you also start getting hemorrhages in the retina. So the OCT of the same patient will showing you that the inflammation has now gone much more into the retina. The retina has also become disorganized, probably also causing those hemorrhages on top. Some of them can be complicated by choroidal neovascular membranes also. And again, you treat with OCT and you get treat with ATT, you get a good regression of the lesion. Now, what is this? Through the haze, you are seeing a creamy lesion. Is it headlight in fog? It is creamy, it is not white. The OCT is again showing you that the lesion is primarily in the choroid, pushing the retina up, and the inflammation going into the sub-RP space here. So again, this patient was found to have systemic tuberculosis, treated with ATT. This is the same optos findings. After resolution, you just get a small scar here. Initially, the other eye had panuveitis. We could not do any imaging. After giving ATT and steroids, the other lesion is also showing you these healed choroidal tuberculoma patches, which is now healed. Again, multifocal patches here. These are also cases of systemic tuberculosis having choroidal tubercles. Same thing I want to highlight. The lesion is in the choroid. Inflammation is now spreading upwards, crossing the RP, going into the outer retinal layers. And you can also see there's a separation of the Bruch's and RP. And sometimes this retains for a long time. The Bruch's doesn't break. Only subsequently with chronic cases, it breaks. And probably that is why it leads to a CNVM formation. Give ATT, again, you can see the nice resolution, and imaging also helps you to document how the patient is responding to therapy, and maybe also could help us limit the duration of therapy in such cases. Now, as opposed to those lesions, this is again a hypolesion in the choroid, but you see this looks more silent. There's not much inflammation going into the RP or above the RP level. And this patient had lymph nodes on CT scan and was finally diagnosed as probable ocular sarcoid, just given steroids. Again, you see the nice resolution of the lesion, although the fundus is still showing those yellowish areas, but definitely smaller than the previous scan. Now, what is this? Now, this was referred to me as a tuberculoma because, again, it is a yellowish lesion there because the patient was MONTU positive. But I just want to emphasize here that in our country, please, just on the basis of isolated MONTU positivity, don't consider everything as tuberculosis. Look at the lesion. It has hemorrhages. It has so much of hard exudates here. So there has to be a breach of either the inner retinal barrier or the outer retinal barrier. You do the OCT, the entire lesion is in the retina. There's nothing in the choroid at all. You do an angiography, you find it is such a vascular lesion. So this is actually a peripapillary hemangioblastoma and not anything else. We treated it with double duration photodynamic therapy, and it has started showing response. Subretinal fluid has absorbed, but unfortunately, because the hard exudates were already too much, there was not much visual recovery. So these lesions could be vascular as well. So again, a large whitish lesion here, but you see the associated hard exudates and the hemorrhages. These should point to you that it might be a vascular lesion rather than anything else. You do an OCT, again you see the lesion is at the level of just above the RP, and you have these pigment epithelial detachments. OCT angiography clearly shows you the new vessels here. So these are fibrovascular PEDs with probably secondary small polyp formation. The same thing we can also see on the fluorescein angiography. But if you just see the late phases, you'll see the pooling. But you go back to your earlier phases, you can see that similar fronds were also visible just on your fluorescein angiography. So even if you don't have OCTA, you can still diagnose these lesions just on OCT and fluorescein angiography. This is again a vascular lesion and nothing else. Retinal tumors, these are typical mulberry shaped, will give you hypolucencies. This is a very typical presentation and cannot be misdiagnosed as anything else probably. But this patient is case of tuberous sclerosis. These also have retinal hamartomas, but these are more flatter. Some of them can have calcification. OCT shows that these lesions are mostly in the inner retina. So these could also confirm the diagnosis of tuberous sclerosis in certain cases. Now this is the last case. This patient is a known case of retinitis pigmentosa. You can see these pigmentary changes, arterial attenuation. But he came to us with diminution of vision in the right eye. Now what is happening additionally in the right eye? Can you see this whitish lesion here? So what is this? Is it again one of those hamartomas? Is it again one of those granulomas? So you have to again go back to your clinical examination. You see the media is also slightly hazy, and this patient also had additional anterior chamber cells, and there is some changes you can see at petaloid at the fovea. So you do further imaging, you see that definitely this has cystoid macular edema. Although this lesion might look similar to you, like the previous one I showed you, basically an inner retinal lesion, but it cannot explain all these findings together. So we thought that this patient is having secondary uveitis, and we treated it with steroids. And this is the first image, and following therapy, you see that was basically a pre-retinal granuloma. It has nicely resolved. You cannot see any of the lesion now. The cystoid macular edema is resolved, and the visual acuity of the patient has improved. So, in conclusion, we have to correlate our clinical findings to understand where the lesion lies. Is it primarily retinal or choroidal or retinochoroidal or a chorioretinal? We then can classify it as an inflammatory lesion, a neoplastic lesion, or a vascular lesion. The other things to be understood are, is it active or is it inactive? And what are the associated changes with it, like a choroidal neovascular membrane or CME, which would need management? Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rohan, for summarizing all the larger lesions of retina and choroid very nicely. Now, we'd like to have some questions. If anyone has any questions to any of the speakers, they're welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for attending this session. And we will invite the speakers of the next session, please. Can we just have a group photograph?